In this video, it's time to clean this Compaq Proliant 3000 from 1999. It's a dual Pentium 3 server. And inside of here, there's a secret bonus thing, which I'm gonna show you, which is actually pretty cool in this video. Hi, my name is Victor Bart, and welcome to Retro Machines. And let's do a little challenge to see how far can I take this apart for cleaning without touching any tools. And a lot of people comment on this machine how big it is and how heavy it is. I think it's now, with some hard drives in it, 45 kilos, up to 50 maybe if it's loaded. And the height of the machine with the feet is 47 centimeters. And without the feet, a little bit under 45 centimeters. So it is a rack mount chassis if you put it flat down. And the width of the machine is 32 centimeters, that is 7U in a rack. And the depth is 59 centimeters, but with this front panel sticking out 61 centimeters. Also, the power supply handles stick out a little bit, so it's actually more like 64 centimeters depth. It's a chunky boy. So let's start with the PCI cards. And we need to remove the SCSI cable and be really careful to not bend the little pins here. They are pretty weak. And we have quick release on the card, so easy to take them out. And this is the 2DH RAID controller, single ultra wide controller, 60 megabyte cache with some battery backup. And the batteries haven't leaked. And I don't know if they still work. I have a replacement card for this for later videos. Then we take out the network card, and that is the Tricom 3C905B. They always work. It's one of my favorite cards. Let's take out the memory. Oh, maybe first just remove the power of the system. And this is a 512 megabyte SD RAM stick, double stacked memory modules from Compaq, probably PC100. And yeah, I like this set. Because 1 gigabyte memory is a lot, and I probably gonna upgrade it to even more than this. So let's remove the CPUs. And this is a Pentium 3 500 megahertz Katmai, 512 kilobyte of cache, also Compaq branded. But here you see the clip that you easily can remove the cool blocks if you upgrade it to faster CPUs like 600 megahertz. But my 600 megahertz have plastic clips, so I can't put those easily back on this CPUs. So not sure if I can use those CPUs to upgrade. Or keep the 600 megahertz for the Asus P2B DS motherboard. Oh, the whole motherboard tray is moving around. Let's see. This is not cheating with the tools, this is saving the motherboard because the CPU is stuck and I don't want to break anything. So this step is not necessary to clean the system. Okay, done. So this is actually a teardown video where I will put the system back together after I cleaned it. Okay, let's continue with our tools. I have some thumb screws here for this mid bar that's connected also here to the fan, and I need to take the fans out. Okay, that was easy. And this thumb screw here on the fan. Okay. So we can hot swap the fans, but there's still a cable attached. So it's not with a quick connector. The VRMs, can we take them out easily? Let them stay where they are, because they have little plastic tabs and I don't want to break them. Also, these fans are here connected to the motherboard. Oh, the motherboard tray is loose in the system, so I probably can take out the motherboard tray too. So the first fan is out. Then we have here the second fan that is here on top. Okay, the top cover was already loose, but held in place here with some kind of thumb screw, which actually not a real thumb screw, but that was already loose, so I don't have to use any tools for that. I've here the thumb screws of the motherboard are loose, and I think I did that myself. Let's remove the cables from the chassis. Is it possible to... I can slide the whole motherboard, but I need to remove more cables, like the floppy cable here. And here the cable to the front. Let's remove the IDE cable. And there's another cable here, probably to the front panel. That's now also loose. Yeah, that goes to the front management panel. And then we have two power cables here. Okay, the motherboard's now free, so... But now the VRM needs to go out, because we don't want to damage it. And this is the VRM. So, some capacitors, some coils, some parts. Okay, I can't get the motherboard out because it's stuck on something. So let's pull the power supplies out, and they are 6 kilo each. They are really heavy, and I need to inspect them because I have some kind of earth problem. And it has super big parts inside, if you can see it. But we will open them in this video. Time to remove the hard drives, and for the thumbnail of the previous video I put some empty ones in to fill up all the holes. But I will fill up this whole machine with hard drives. And here we have the two boot drives. They are both 72 gigabyte 15,000 RPM. And here I have four 300 gigabyte 10,000 RPM hard drives, and I will do a separate video about that one, because they are pretty interesting to use 300 gigabytes in an old system like this with a vintage RAID controller. It works, but on the other hand it also had a big limit. But I will make a separate video about the big hard drives in this system, because that's fun. Spoiler alert, I can probably go up to 3 terabytes in Pentium 3. So we have some thumb screws here, but normally there are more screws in the panel, but I took them off when I was researching it. But the panel can stay on if you remove the whole front drive unit. So still no cheating with tools, and we are still toolless. And as you can see, there's one screw here that holds this one in place. There's a handle here that you need to pull out. And then you can move the drive base forward. So let's remove the power cable from the inside here. And then the whole drive assembly comes out. So if you need to move this server around, you can take all the drives out and save a lot of weight in the chassis. So even this plastic windshield thing is in with plastic tabs. So also no tools yet. Only the motherboard, and then I have everything out. But without that shield, I probably have more room to do the motherboard. Yeah, now it moves back. Unit here is out. Maybe I can lift it, because now the CPU brackets are in the way to move it further back. But I can lift it out. So the motherboard is also out, and we can take a better look on the motherboard. And my table is getting a little bit full. If you look really close, you can already see the hidden secret of the Compact ProLiant 3000. But let's take a look at all the parts, and I didn't need a screwdriver to take this machine apart. So we have a network card, SCSI RAID controller, the memory, the VRMs, two CPUs, two big fans, one small fan, two hard drives, the motherboard, two power supplies, the chassis itself with here the management module, and the big drive bay with the CD-ROM player, and the floppy drive is still here in the chassis. With the motherboard out of the system, we can take a good look on it. We have two slot 1 CPUs up to Pentium 3 600 MHz, but also the motherboard still supports Pentium 2 from 233 up to 450, and the Pentium 3 450 up to 600. And if you have an earlier model without normal ESA slots, with the A ESA slots, it only supports 66 MHz front side bus Pentium 2, so the Pentium 2 233 to 333. So this is the later model of the motherboard. That means that I have normal ESA slots and not A ESA slots. That would be epic if I would have them. I still need to find a system with A ESA slots. We have 8 PCI slots, that's a lot. But the problem is, it's only normal PCI, not PCI 64. And they all share the same bus. So don't expect any high performance from this system with big arrays and gigabit networking and stuff. The three ESA slots are shared with the last three PCI slots, and I really like this configuration because if you want to fill it up with PCI cards, you can do it. And if you have ESA cards, you can put it in here, and then this slot became unusable. But in every configuration, you can put in 8 cards. Here we have the onboard LSE SCSI controller. It's ultra wide, but 2-channel, and also a channel on the back, and that's probably shared with one of those ports. Here a Super I/O chip, probably for all the expansion cards. We have one IDE channel for the CD-ROM player. We have a floppy controller here. This port is for the front LCD. And we have 8 memory banks, and it supports up to 4 gigabyte memory because of the ServerWorks chipset. And that is really epic to have a Pentium 3 with a lot of memory support. The 440BX only goes to 1 gigabyte of memory, and the 440GX goes only to 2 gigabyte of memory, so this is much nicer. And here we have the two ports for the VRMs, for the power delivery to the CPUs. So if you buy like this system in a single CPU version, you probably have only one installed, and then you need to find a second CPU and a VRM. Here we have the AT video card with 1 megabyte memory, that's this chipset, and no USB or any other fancy things. But I really like the layout of this motherboard because we have so much expansion, so much memory support, and dual CPU. Here you have a schematic to set these switches for the CPU speed, and here you have switches for some system configuration like disable onboard video, lock configuration, rack mounted system, not sure why you need a switch for that, enable floppy boot, skip boot password, and clear configuration. Here we have the two massive power supplies. They are 750 watt each on 200 to 240 volt and 500 watt from 100 to 120 volt. And on this one there's a sticker 29503. So probably 29 May 2003 there was something with this power supply. Maybe it's replaced, maybe not, or checked. And I checked all the stickers and they have completely the same number. So not sure if this one is replaced and this is the original one. But let's open them because I want to inspect them inside and also clean them inside. If I inspect the power supply, all the parts seem okay, nothing burned. All the caps are fine. It's pretty clean. There's some dust in it, but no smokers stuff or things sticking to the fans. So I think this machine is well maintained. And also the chassis here, it is only dusty and nothing else. Yeah, I think this system is pretty clean for its age of 22 years old. If we take a look in the system, we have some dust here on this corner where there's not much airflow, and here on the bottom. But for the rest, where the fans are, it's pretty clean, so the airflow is really helping also to blow out the dust. And it's also not like super dirty dust, so the dust is probably just pieces of clothes or something like that, but nothing that's super dirty. So I will take my air compressor, blow everything out, put it back on the table and reassemble this super nice server. Even the empty shell is really, really happy. That's the biggest disadvantage of this system, the weight. Here's my air compressor and all the parts and the chassis. I cleaned the inside of the case and there was only dust inside, so time to put it together. I removed the side panel here and put it on its side, and it looks freaking epic as a rack mount 7U chassis. And here is the hidden bonus feature that is in my Compaq, and that is a brand new SCSI cable with 68 pin connectors, 3 pieces here and 1 for through the motherboard and a termination. So this is like a $150 cable that they already included in the system. So if you install something in the 5.25 inch base, like a tape streamer or something like that, the cable is already inside of the chassis and really hidden away here with the drive base here and the power supplies there in the rear. And as you can see, it's also under the motherboard. So yeah, I found this out when I first was exploring how to take this case apart, and I think this is a really awesome detail. I never seen this before. The first thing we're gonna put back into the system is of course the motherboard. And super easy with the thumb screws. So we're gonna put back the VRMs. Now we're gonna put back the CPUs, and on most systems they are like this, but on this system they are like this. That looks really awesome. And the CPU cooler is shaped like the first Pentium 2 CPUs. So the brackets here are made for the Pentium 2s. So if you're gonna install faster CPUs, you need to use this cool blocks. Otherwise they won't fit here in the rails. Let's put the memory back. And you need to be really careful because 512 megabyte SD RAM sticks are a bit rare. And I even have 1 gigabyte SD RAM sticks. So maybe I should try it out in this system one day and see if it supports 8 gigabyte or not. Let's put the fans back, and with the thumb screw it screws here in the middle. So we need to route the cable and then drop in the cooler and then simply lock it with the thumb screw in place and connect the cable on the motherboard. And let's put the network card back in the system, and I put it in the same slot, otherwise I need to run the configure software again and change the slots. And the RAID controller goes back for now, and in a later video I will upgrade it to the Smart Array 3200 and more SCSI drives. But I think it's cool to make a separate SCSI video. And then we have this bar. I'm not sure why they have it, but it looks cool. And they have pins here and a thumb screw on this side and also a thumb screw on this side. It maybe makes the case a little bit stronger and a little bit heavier because yeah, this server is super heavy. Now let's see which cables go where. These are the power cables, and you need to be really careful with the plastic because after 22 years it can break off. This is a floppy drive cable that goes under here, and then the cable of the front LCD screen, and then we have more cables that come from the front that goes on this header. maybe for some buttons and lights. Oh, and this cable goes to the power distribution board by the power supplies, so they probably can communicate between the power supplies and the main board for management. The case looks a little bit sad with the side panel and the feet removed, so on its side. So, and there are clips here that slide in slots here, and then two screws from the front. I have here a drive cage from a Compaq ML370, I think, or a 370 G2, and it fits in here. So if I really want, I can modify this chassis that I can take 6 hard drives here, 6 hard drives here. That would be interesting. And the nice thing about this one is that you then can split up the SCSI cables to 2 controllers or to 2 channels. And even there's a bridge here. So I think you can even split up this drive cage, that 2 drives are like your boot drives on one controller and 4 data drives on the other controller. So this is the more modern drive bay with more functionality. But the issue with modifying it with 2 drive cages of this type is that you need to modify also the cooling, because there's no fan on the rear of this drive cage. And you need to find a power connector and probably make your own cable, because this is 8 pin and this one is 12 pin. So let's focus on the original tray. And by the 5.25 inch base, I like that you just can screw in your drives instead of having the special trays on both sides, like the DL380 and the ML370. So I don't need extra parts to install more drives. And here we have the IDE cable. And we have here drive 0 and here drive 1. And the drive is on cable select. So this is a cable select cable. So probably if I have a second EDA device, I will probably try it out on cable select and see if it works. And here on the rear we have 3 fans of 6 centimeters for the cooling, with a nice plastic air tunnel. And here we have the 12 pin power connector, but also a power out to power the drives with this cable. And here we have only 1 SCSI port to use to the backplane. So I cannot split up the 10 hard drives over 2 controllers with this backplane. And here we can install the 10 hard drives. And we have the 80 pin SCSI connector in the back that powers it and have data over it. And that's an industry standard, so you can easily replace the hard drives from other brands in a chassis like this. And here we have the CD-ROM player, and the brand is Compaq Computers. Now let's put the drive base back in the chassis. And the SCSI cable we can do from this side, so I don't have to do that now. But the power cable we need to connect. So let's put some drives in a little bit. And then from this side I can connect the power cable. So now I need to route the IDE cable to the right spot. Thank you. it's now time to power the server again, but the last time I powered it, I tripped all the fuses in the home. So, I'm a little bit scared to power it, but let's do it. Okay, that went much better. And the display is now on. Not sure why they tripped the last time, but at least we can try to boot up the system and see if it still works. And I already put some lights as backup on batteries. We now have 1.9 volt between the earth of the chassis and the earth in the wall connection. And the server itself is also just earthed, so there's something not correct. And that's probably tripped the fuses last time. It takes a while sometimes when you power it up before the system is alive, like this, a few seconds, sometimes longer. And the RAID controller will give an error that one array is missing, because I didn't put back the 300 gigabyte SCSI drive for now. Only the boot drives. Oh, IO-FAN3 not present. That's probably on the wrong header. And the array is missing error, but F1 to continue. Ah, this one is on the CPU header instead of the other header. And the IDE cable is not plugged in correctly. Oh, and probably this header is also on the wrong header. So let's turn it off. Fix this header. Push in the IDE cable. Oh no, that's FAN2 redundant CPU. And FAN1 CPU, so the top one is okay, but it was the lower one. And this one is also okay, because there's only one fan header. And this is called the CPU fan, because it blows over the CPU. And this is probably the secondary CPU fan. Fan CPU aux. So this is probably optional if you have two CPUs. And this one is to cool the RAID controllers and other PCI cards. The fan error is now fixed, but let's just fix the SCSI error and put back all the drives, because I don't like SCSI errors and I just like SCSI too much to have errors. And Jonathan made a meme of me. SCSI! Thanks, Jonathan. So let's put back the hard drives. And I'm not sure if it matters in which position they go back in. I try to keep them like in the same order, but I forget if this was the first or the last disk. So we have the local disk, that's the C drive, that are the 272 gigabyte 15,000 RPMs in RAID. And here in new volume, the E drive, it's 838 gigabyte, because that is in RAID 5 of the 4 300 gigabyte hard drives. So on this very old controller, the 300 gigs work, only when I want to configure it, it's not supported. And this array was already on the drive, so that's why it worked. In the next video I will dive into the SCSI setup and the RAID and the other RAID controller and setting it up, showing you where the limits are and the whole SCSI thing. So be prepared for a complete SCSI video. So let's shut down the system, because everything is working. To be honest, the inside of the system was pretty clean and well maintained, but the top here of the system has like paint drops and some stains, so I still need to clean the outside, but at least the inside is done now. So let's see if we can make the top a little bit better, and the feet have some dirt on it, so yeah, let's clean the outside. So here we have the paint drop, so let's see if we can just push it off. Okay, this works. And the white paint of Compaq is really strong, so it won't scratch that easy. There are some scratches on here, but not that much. So now it's time for the special computer cleaner. I imported it from Denmark. It's Class Cleaner Klasker from First Price. And this is absolutely the best to clean computer cases. So if this doesn't work, you probably need a flamethrower. So the Danish computer cleaner helped a little bit. So I probably need to clean it more later after this video. Let's see if I can clean the feet here. So let's use some benzene to see if I can clean this black spot. Okay, the benzene did the trick. I still need to clean it a little bit more, but the black stripe here is gone. Let's talk about something that's wrong with my channel, and it's quite serious. Maybe you noticed there are no ads on my videos anymore because my monetization is disabled, because my AdSense account is disabled because of illegal click activities. And I'm not sure if I ever can fix it without talking with someone high up in YouTube. That's quite a problem. But there is a solution, and that is using my Amazon affiliated links or following me on Patreon. I really hope that you want to consider one of those options, because yeah, I'm missing a little bit of income to buy the servers like this and the cards, the extra expansions, and build my server rack. And yeah, I'm still doing it from my normal income. But investing in this hobby is a little bit more difficult now without the YouTube income. So what you can do, of course, is use my Amazon affiliate links and get these nice shiny packages. And if you use an Amazon affiliated link, you get it for the normal price, and I will get a little kickback of it. And that little bit of money really helps. So let's unbox this package that I got in today, because it's for my home rack. Oh, there's three boxes inside. Let's throw that away so you don't see my address. Oh, this a lot of plastic. Unnecessary plastic. But I have PETS cables here. And more. And more. So let's show you the PETS cables in detail. They are 15 centimeters. Just Cat 5E. That's more than enough for my home rack. And the little cables make the rack super nice and tidy. And there's an unnecessary label on the cable. So what you can do is make super short runs, so you don't have a big cable spaghetti in your rack. And I will put links to this product in all kinds of colors and different lengths down in the description. And the quality of these cables are really good. So as you can see, I have a lot of runs here. They are just perfectly fine. And as you can see, the short cables work really well in my server rack. And a nice thing about this cable is you don't have to worry that this clip breaks off, because there's an extra clip to protect them. 30 PETS cables ready to use, and that's why I like this drawer in my rack. I can now simply open the drawer, take out the PETS cable, patch it up. And if I have a PETS cable that I remove, I just drop it, close the drawer, done. The other option to help me is Patreon, where you support me each month with a little bit of money. So if 50 or 100 of you will help me with like $1 a month, that would help so much. So I have some budget to spend on my rack and all the old computers, get some specific parts, get a new power supply for my Q6600. So yeah, please check out my Patreon and consider becoming a Patreon. That would help a lot. So if we get 50 Patreons, I will make a Discord, so we have a chat room, or maybe an IRC server, one of the two. So we have an exclusive chat where you can ask me things, show you projects to me, and maybe I can make videos where I review your retro systems, something like that. So you can post the pictures on Discord and I can easily see them. So yeah, let me know what you think about that. Of course, there's a third option, but that's a little bit difficult, and that is channel sponsors. So if a company wants to sponsor me with products that I like, that I use, where I stand behind, I'm really open to talk about that. And if we have enough Patreons, I can set up one Sun V100 as like a community server for my Patreons, where you can remote log in and then we can just have fun on an old server and run stuff on it and play with it. So let me know what you think about that, to have like one Sun V100 running 24/7 for my Patreons. And they use like 30-35 watt each, so they don't use that much power. But I probably want to have a fiber internet connection here, and it's coming, but they don't say when. So it's probably over 2 years. I hope not. In the first video of this machine, we tested it out. We set it up with the Smart Start CD. We made the RAID array on the SCSI drives, installed Windows 2000 Advanced Server. And in this video, the second video, we completely cleaned it, took it apart, took a close look on the motherboard. So the next video of this machine will be a full SCSI video, where I explore the RAID controllers, set up more drives in here, show you the options and the cards and the limitations. And what I really love about this ProLiant 3000, this is the last model, so the newer model, with a modern hard drive. So I can put in a lot of options and a lot of storage. So that will be fun to make. And also I will make a video after that with network cards and all kinds of stuff and setting up the server and a lot of content. And the responses that I get on this machine are really cool. There are so much stories about people that broke their backs, that managed them back in the days, that run companies on it. It's just, some people bought it for like super cheap, they played with it. So yeah, it's a really famous machine and it's rock solid, super stable, and as you can see, all the hardware after 22 years looks perfectly fine. We will have a lot of fun with this machine, and I maybe found a compact DL380 and a compact CL380, and the CL380 is two DL 380s in one chassis with a storage unit on top. It's only like more than 1000 kilometers away in a non-European Union country, and with COVID it's really impossible to get it. I will see what I can do. That would be great to make videos about those machines too, and make a complete retro network setup with more than one server and clustering and the good old stuff. And then the Sun V100 will be the Unix machines in the network, and that will be a really impressive setup. There will be much more content on my channel, so consider to be a Patreon, and thanks for watching.